Excellent. Thank you, Sarah. All right. So, welcome to Cohort 1 of the Effect Book Club. Today, we're going to be doing the first half of Chapter 15 on simulation. So, today, we will be doing basically an introduction to what simulation is, some intros on what simulation can do and how to code it in R, Python, and Stata. And next week, we will dive into using simulation to conduct power analysis, as well as bootstrapping with existing data using simulation. As you'll see, today we're going to be going old school and we're going to be scrolling through the book just because I don't have full R capabilities set up on my computer yet. I've got some things working, but R markdown and stuff isn't quite cooperating yet. So hopefully we'll get that fixed for next week. All right. So the author starts by talking about how statistical research generally talks about things that are at least slightly false. So in any sort of application of statistics, we're often applying models that are not perfect. There's the famous saying, not all model or no model is good, but at least some are useful. And I butchered the quote, but all of my biologist friends will be very upset with me. But generally, we're working with something that's not completely true. However, the discipline of statistics itself is almost entirely true, and that's because statistical methods are developed using mathematical proofs. So basically, if we're making a set of assumptions here, if we're assuming A, B, and C, then based off of the laws of mathematics and statistics, we can prove that D is true. Of course, A, B, and C are assumptions, and when we're applying these statistical proofs, these statistical relationships, we are assuming that A, B, and C are applying in our particular case. And this is where the falsehoods come in. Often A, B, and C are not completely applicable. Often we are violating these assumptions, even if in a small way. And what we're going to be talking about throughout this chapter is how we can use tools like simulation where we know how and why the assumptions are being violated. We can start to assess how bad those assumption violations are and whether they are impacting our results in any meaningful or problematic way. So the author talks a little bit about statistical proofs and how great they are because they let us know how our estimates work, which is extremely, extremely important. But they admit that most people, myself included here, don't actually know the statistical proofs that we're using. We're just kind of taking the work of the sort of hardcore mathematics angled statisticians and applying their hard work to our sort of our more complicated problems, shall we say. But even if we don't want to go through all the trouble or Yeah, if we don't want to go through all the trouble of, actually understanding the nitty-gritty of the simulation, we do still need to have some idea of how and why our methods are working. And this is where simulation can provide a sort of alternative to actually diving in and doing proofing. So, in the context of this chapter, simulation refers to the process of using a random process that we have control over. So, in this case, our data generating process to produce data that we can evaluate with a given method. We'll do that repeatedly and then look at the results over all of our repetitions to assess whether they follow sort of the expected results based on what we think is happening with the data. What's really cool here is that because we have complete control over the randomness that is occurring, we're essentially choosing what the truth is. We don't need to worry about what assumptions apply in our case. We don't need to worry about whether, whether we're missing parts of the data generating process, whether we're missing a backdoor or anything like that, because we are creating everything from scratch. Then, once we sort of create our imaginary scenario, we get to see what kind of results a particular method will produce given the truths that we have established for our model. We know that that is the true effect because we chose the true effect, and then we can compare that to some real world scenario and see how closely our sort of our completely known example matches up with the partially unknown example. Now, simulation is a little bit different from a lot of the types of methods that we've used sort of throughout the book so far, because we are not just taking a package that somebody else has written with math written in already that we don't have to think about. We actually have to program everything basically from scratch, which is a very useful skill to have, but also makes this a little bit daunting. So the author gives a basic example with flipping a coin 100 times and estimating the probability of coming up heads. I don't know. I honestly didn't really like this example very much. I don't know why. It just didn't feel helpful to me. I think it was much more informative to just actually walk through the actual programming with sort of more mathematically challenging, maybe, examples. So I'm just going to sort of skip over this part. One thing I do want to touch on, though, is this sort of side note where the author says that, while we can use simulation to sort of convince ourselves that a good estimator is a good estimator, it sort of like helps quell the little voice in the back of your head that's like, no, what if it's wrong? It is a little bit more challenging to use simulation to prove the value of an estimator to others. And this is because, you're never going to cover every possibility in simulation. You can only show that a simulation works for the particular a data generating process that you've chosen. So if you, let's say you use a simulation, you think that it shows that something is a good estimator, you try to publish that, it is entirely possible that you will get a reviewer who will say, oh, but like, what about X, Y, and Z? I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing, because if you genuinely haven't thought about those, then it can be good to think about it. But basically, what the author is trying to get at is that proofs are much more concrete in that they tell you whether something works or not, whereas simulation, you're only picking out very specific cases, and it's a little bit harder to generalize from a simulation. But it can be very useful when comparing with real-world data. One of the values of simulation is understanding an estimator sampling distribution. These can be tricky to figure out, particularly if you have an analysis that has multiple steps in it or uses multiple estimators. So simulation can help to figure out the degree of sampling variation without having to write a proof. Simulation is also very helpful in understanding how robust an estimation method can be to violation of assumptions. So we sort of touched on that a little bit earlier, and how sensitive estimates are to changes in the truth. This is where I personally sort of really like the idea of simulation, because I work with biological data sets, and biology is always messy. Whether that's in taking our measurements of individual specimens, the author talks about, using different size calipers with different sort of error ranges. You might have data collected by different people. You will always get things that are close but not quite normally distributed, things like that. So using simulation can be a really powerful tool to assess how all of these annoyances that make your data not perfect, how bad they actually are, and can help you sort of think about ways to counteract that. So as a summary, simulation is a process of using random processes that we have complete control over to repeatedly apply an estimator to different samples. The three major things that the author highlights that this allows us to do is we can test whether our estimates will give us the true effect when they're applied to the random data generating process that we have chosen. We can get a sense of the sampling distribution of our estimate, which you couldn't do with just a random single sample, a single data set. And we can see how sensitive an estimator is to certain assumptions. The author also promises that once you get the hang of it, you'll be doing simulations all the time, and they're not just useful, they're addictive, which I can totally understand. While I haven't really like making the jump into doing simulations all the time yet, I've definitely started being like, ooh, I bet simulation could help figure that out. It could help figure that out and all that stuff. The next section is basically all about coding up simulations, because no matter which way you slice it, performing simulations in the modern era requires coding it in. What's lucky is that statistical simulation is actually quite simple conceptually. It can get complicated depending on what it is you're trying to model, but basically you only need five things. You need a process for generating random data. You need an estimation. You need a way of iterating the steps repeatedly, a way of storing the estimation results from each iteration, and a way of looking at the distribution of estimates across iterations. So the first question is, how do we get a process for generating random data? In pretty much every statistical programming language, there are functions for generating random data according to all sorts of distributions. As we talked about earlier, there's a number of different data distributions. We can do random uniform data, which generates variables that must lie within certain bounds. In our examples, we'll be using 0 to 1, I believe, although now I can't. Now I'm questioning myself. RUNIF, which I always pronounce internally in my head as RUNIF, which is. Sounds like it's doing something completely different, is the function in R. And NumPy, random, uniform, and Python. I'm only going to talk about the R and Python bits because I believe everybody who's in the book club right now, I think everybody uses R, but I don't think anybody uses Stata, so yeah. We can do normal random data for generating continuous variables that have a normal distribution. This is going to mimic real-world distributions in many cases. So in R, this would be R norm and NumPy random normal in Python. And if we're using categorical or binary variables, we can use the sample function in R or NumPy random. Random interval, I think, in Python. That said, there are limitations in Stata and Python for doing categorical or binary variables, in the sense that those functions only really work for categorical data with equal chances. There's in Python, you can do a NumPy random binomial for binary data with a probability P of getting a one. And then there is a workaround, which is in the sort of footnotes if you're interested in doing some unequal chance categorical variable stuff in Python. One thing that the author highlights, and I think is important to emphasize, is that anytime we're talking about randomness in computers, we're actually talking about pseudo-random data. So random number generators, or RNGs, in programming languages are actually very predictable. They are not completely random because that's how computers work. And in order to generate replicable data when we're doing simulation like this, it is extremely important that we set a seed. So what you'll see is in all of the coding examples, there will be a set seed function. You would set this at the beginning, and it will make sure that every time you run the same simulation, whether you run it between different computers or you close your computer, open it up, and run it again, you will get the same results rather than generating slightly different results every time. So we will start out with running a or making a simple data table using random numbers. So we start off by loading the tidyverse library and setting our seed. In this case, we're going to be using the seed 1000, but you can use whatever number you want. When running through these examples, I mean, I would say when running through these examples, I would use the same number, but in the actual chapter, he doesn't really talk about the results too much. He just kind of is like, here we go, here's the simulation. There's like one figure that we'll talk about today. All right, so we set our seed, and then we can use the tibble function from the tidyverse to create a tibble, which is a specialized data frame in case anybody hasn't worked with tidy data before. And then we pick our number of observations. So in this case, we're going to pick the number 200. So here we will make a tibble. EPS here is our error term, and we're basically saying we're taking 200 samples from a normal distribution for our error term. By default, our norm has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. For our y values, we're taking a uniform distribution. We're taking 200 samples again. And for our x values, we are taking a sample of values either 0 or 1. I found this sort of made it seem like you're sampling continuous variables, so you could go anywhere from 0 to 1, but it's actually you're choosing either 0 or 1. Getting 200 observations, sampling with replacement, and your probability of getting a 0 is 0.8, and probability of getting a 1 is 0.2. So this is a really basic way to generate random numbers. We've done everything manually, and as we're going to go through, we're going to learn how to sort of expand this simple example to make it more repeatable, more replicable, and more complex. So what we're going to start by doing is we are going to start by mimicking this causal diagram in code. So here we are interested in the effect of X on Y, and then we also have W, which affects both X and Y, and we have our error term over here. So things that we want to code in here, I've noted these down separately because I found it was a little bit complex. So we need to code in that W causes X and Y. In this case, we are going to show that X is more likely to be 1 when W is true, I guess, and Y will decrease. We will see that our error term is now part of creating X. So we're actually going to incorporate it into the data generating process for the value of X by including it as uniform random data. We will code that the true effect of X on Y is that for a 1 unit increase in X, we will see a 3 unit increase in Y. And we will also have an unlisted additional source of variation in creating Y. This is going to basically be the error term if we regress Y on X and W, and it's represented by random normal data in the code. So I just want to highlight that last bit with our sort of extra random data. So what we're talking about here is that if we only follow this diagram to the letter, it would imply that Y would be completely determined by only X and W. So we would not see any variation in Y once we control for them. That never happens in real life. So that's where we get this V coming in, which is basically the residuals if we're accounting for both X and W in a regression on Y. All right, so this is the R code for it. We start off very similar to how we did in the last example. We have our tidyverse library. We set our seed to the exact same number, 1000. And we are adding in W. So we have our W here. It's a random uniform function that only goes from 0 to 0.1. We're using the mutate function of dplyr to add the x variable here. Again, random uniform function, creating 200 observations and adding in W as our sort of as having an interaction. That's not the word I'm looking for, but as control, as being part of the data generating process for X. Then we get Y, which is the variable that we're interested in predicting. And you'll see here, here's our true effect of Y. So for every unit increase in X, we get a 3 unit increase in Y. We add an effect of W, and then this R norm 200 is our V there, so our sort of extra residual once we control for X and W. So as you can see here, our true effect of X and Y is 3. So what we're looking for is that in when running this multiple times, we are hoping that our coefficient for X will be 3 or very close to 3. So this is how we would create these variables once with a single set of 200 observations. But we want to do this repeatedly in order to get a better sense of how our data behaves over or how our data generating process behaves when you take multiple samples from it. So this is where the concept of creating our own functions is going to come in. So, all right, let's make a function. So we start off the same. Library tidyverse, set seed 1000. And here we're going to take this code from up here that creates the tuple. And we are going to wrap it in this function call. So anytime you're creating a function, you'll have function and then bracket. And then anything you want to supply to the function as an argument, you will have in these first set of curly bracket, not curly brackets, of regular brackets. So here we want to be able to set our sample size or a number of observations every time we call the function, and we are setting a default of 200. Then within the function, it will look almost exactly the same as what we had above, with the exception that anytime we had 200 representing the number of observations, we have replaced it with the uppercase N. This essentially means that anytime we run create data, we can either supply it with a number of observations or N that will get input wherever N is within the function, or if we don't supply anything, it will default to 200. So we run, or in our within our function, we've got our tuple, and then in order to actually be able to see what the created data is or to use it in any further way, we do need to return that in some way. So we need some way to tell the program to like store that information and give it to us in another format. So here we just have return D or return our data frame. Then we can run our function, and here we will run it with 500 observations instead of 200. So this is the most basic form of creating our own data generating process and running our own simulation. But more often than not, we're going to need something more complex. A very common added level of complexity is mimicking a panel structure that has multiple observations per individual. So what we need to do here is we need to create an individual identifier, give that individual some individual characteristics, and then we need to apply these to an entire time range of data, so multiple observations for a single individual. Basically, what we'll do is make an individual data set with an individual time data set, and then we'll merge those two together. So the first thing we need to do is need to create the sort of overall structure for our panel data. So we're not quite mimicking the we will be mimicking the code above, but with some added complexity. So first, we need to create the individual IDs. We do this using the crossing function. This makes every combination of two vectors. So in this case, we create our panel data by crossing an ID to N. So if we use our defaults, we'll have 1 to 200. So there, our ID numbers will go 1, 2, 3, 4, blah, 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 199, 200. And then we want T for time to go from 1 equals T. So this will set the number of repeat observations of the same individual, in this case 10, or in our default case 10, I should say. So we've got our individual numbers, and then we want to add individual or time varying data. So we will mutate a random uniform function for the number of rows in the data set. with 0 and 0.1. This is just as we did above. So we had W N 0, 0.1. And then we will do individual specific data. So this is separate from the panel data. So we've got our panel data. We're now creating our individual data. We will do the exact same thing. We'll have ID 1 to N. So we'll have 1 to 200 in our default case, just as we did in the first tuple. And then we will create our second set of individual specific characters. So here, W2 is going to be a normal distribution with the number of observation, or yeah, with N being the number of observations that's pulled. So 200 in the default case. We'll then take this panel data tuple and the individual data tuple and join them. In this case, we're basically just taking the panel data and then just sort of gluing on the individual data. So we're doing a full join, joining them by ID. So it'll join them by that 1 to 200 individual ID number. We will create X, which in this case is going to be caused by W1 and W2. So our two sort of our panel data, our panel data and our individual specific characteristics. So X equals 2 times N1 plus 1.5 times W2 plus our normal pulling the number of rows, and create Y. So once again, we have the true effect of X on Y is 3, but we have causal effects from both W1 and W2. Then we return that. So what you'll notice here is because our function call actually has two parameters that we need to supply when we are running our create panel data function, we also need to supply two parameters. So we need to supply N. So we're taking 100 observations and 5 for the number of observations per individual. Another thing that we have to be concerned about in the creation of random data is in creating correlated error terms. This is if we know or suspect that our error terms not independent from our variables, which is extremely common. There's a couple things that are sort of especially important to consider. So the first is heteroscedasticity, and the second is clustering. Heteroscedasticity is pretty easy to create. Basically, you just allow the variance of the data to be based on the observation's characteristics. So in our heteroscedastic data model, we're going back to a relatively simple tuple, as we did a couple code examples above. And in the Y, the function for generating our Y values, basically what we're doing is we have our true effect. So 1 unit increase in X is 3 unit increase in Y. And then this is our error term. And what you'll notice is the standard deviation of our error is dependent on X. So the higher value of X, the greater standard deviation we will have. We can plot this. This is one of the examples where he actually shows us what his what his data generating process looks like once it's conducted. And you can see very obviously that we have heteroscedastic data. We've got very small standard deviations on the low end of X and very high standard deviations on the high end of X. So modeling heteroscedasticity, very easy. Modeling clustering is A little bit harder, but it's not that bad. So the first step with clustering is that you need something to cluster at. This is often going to be a group identifier, like the ID numbers that we generated in the panel data example. And then we can create clustered standard errors by either creating or randomly generating a single group effect that can be shared by the group itself. Basically adding on to the level, the noise that's seen at the individual level. So, in other words, you generate an individual level error term and then an individual slash time level error term, and then add those together to get clustered standard errors. So, basically, we can do this by just building on how we created the panel data. So here we're going to create our clustered data. We're going to create our panel data very similarly, our individual data quite similarly. You can see here we've got C. That's our error cluster, which is normally distributed. And we will see that the error term has two components, so the individual cluster C and the individual and time varying element. So C, ooh, that was fun. And then we've got our norm. So this entire thing here is our error term. So a lot of the time we're trying to get our estimators out. A tricky thing at this point is going to be figuring out how to get the estimate you want. Usually this is going to be a coefficient, but not always. If you're after a coefficient within a linear regression, it's pretty easy. You can in R you can do coef M being your model, and then in square brackets put the variable name that you're interested in. In Python you can do m dot params var name for a model M. If you need to extract something else, it will depend on what type of model you're running. These examples, they only work for linear regression. I work a lot with non-linear models, and the coefficients are slightly different there, and there are different ways to get them out. But generally, if you search how to get a statistic from analysis in R, then there are probably many people on the internet who have tried to figure that out. So, all right, so once again, calling out how our coefficients change over time is something that we're going to call repeatedly. So we put it in a function. So this is where we're going to start not doing everything in its own chunk, but in this case, we're going to be referencing to the cluster data function that we made in the previous section. So here's our function for estimation. We've got our N and our T. We will pull, or we will run our cluster data generating process once within this function. So we're nesting a function within a function. We will run a model that should be unbiased if clustered errors don't bias us. So in this case, we're running a linear model of Y on X plus W, with our clustered data as our data set for this linear model. And then we will take the coefficient of X, which, as we know from the previous sort of section, should have a true value of 3 on average, and then return. So we'll run our model 200 times with five in five times or five observations per individual is what I'm trying to say. So the trouble here is that this is basically just running our simulation once. We don't want to do that. We want to run our simulation over and over and over again because there's a chance that anytime we run a simulation once, we are getting an aberrant or weird result. We really often want to know about the distribution of what our estimator gives us, either to check how spread out it is or if the mean is close to the truth. How many times you're going to run your simulation is going to depend a lot on what you're trying to get out of it. When you're first testing out your code, you'll probably only run it one or a few times just to make sure the code works. And then you'll run it more once you're trying to get actual results. So bootstrapping usually is like 1,000 iterations. Figuring out a correlation or a coefficient for a linear regression, you probably want a few thousand. If you want to precisely estimate percentiles of a sampling distribution, then you're probably going to want tens of thousands of iterations. So it all depends on what you want. So the generic way to run any sort of iteration is going to be through a for loop, which usually takes the form of for I in insert vector of numbers, print I or do whatever with I. So in this case, for I in 1, 4, 5, 10, print I, your function would print 1, then it would print 4, then it would print 5, then it would print 10. Looping is going to be slightly different in every language. The author says that Python has the purest loop, which looks a lot like this sort of example above. Base R does actually look very similar to that, but the author recommends using the per package and the map functions, which will be useful later on, but look less like a standard for loop. So do with that what you will. So, in our first example here, we're going to take our est model function that we created in the last code block and we're going to run it 1,000 times. So, we take the numbers 1 to 1,000, we map them onto, or we use the map function to take our function, estimated model. We provide it with n equals 200 and t equals 5. In this case, we're using the map double function because our model output is a double, but there are a number of other map functions. Honestly, the only one I've ever used is just map. I haven't really used the map double or anything like that before. We talk a little bit for a while about storing the results. I'm not going to go over that here because this is only really a concern with strata. In R and Python, they're designed to store your results as you generate them, as long as you're providing the correct code. So how do store results is not as big of an issue here, so I'm just gonna skip over that. And the last thing we need to do is to evaluate. So we've got up here, we've got our estimates, but what do we do with those estimates? We need to actually figure out what, are they telling us what we want to do? So what we're interested here is we know that from our sort of true data generating process that we've decided on, that the true effect of X on Y is 3. So we're looking to see if we get an average effect of 3. So what we're going to do is we're just going to take a simple mean of our estimates, and this will give us a mean of 3.00047, which is pretty close. And this means that in this case, clustered errors alone are not going to bias an otherwise unbiased estimate. We may also be interested in the standard errors because so the distribution of estimates across all of our random samples should mimic the sampling distribution. So in this case, we're just using the standard deviation of our results as the standard error of the estimates. In R, very easy, it's just SD. In Python, it's numpy.std. This shows us a standard deviation of 0.45. This means that an honest linear regression estimator should give standard errors of 0.5. We could simulate in order to figure out if that's the case. If we do that a few different times, we find that depending on what we do, we can get a reported standard error of 0.44, which is just slightly off. But if we treat the standard errors as we should, given the clustered errors that we know we created and use standard errors clustered at the group level, we get 0.45. So as long as we're taking into account the clustering, as we would expect, we get the answer that we want. I didn't go into the broom package and everything here. You can do it with just the coefficient argument, but it's just slightly wordier and less easy to run. I think we should probably stop there. And we'll start with section 15.3, the old man and the sea, next time. Are there any questions in the last like 5 minutes before we wrap up for today?
No, thank you. This is really good.
You.
So is the goal to complete this? Do you feel comfortable completing chapter 15 one more week, or do you need two more sessions?
I'm not 100% sure yet. I think one would probably be fine because I feel like now that we know how to code the simulations, I think that's kind of the it takes the most explanation, but it's possible it might need to. I was hoping to do the old man in the sea today as well, but I didn't have a good sense of like how long it would take to explain the code chunks.
We can revisit, because next week you're already scheduled, and then we have a week off for daylight savings that first week in
Yeah.
November. So depending on where we get, we can adjust for
Yeah.
after we
Yeah.
get
I
next
should have
week.
a better idea, hopefully, like closer to the end of this week too, how sort of bad it is, but
Awesome. And I apologize for the absence for the past month. I had like everything and was scheduled right during this time that I had started a course, and there was a second.